الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيد الأولين والآخرين، سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا محمد، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، I want to relate to you maybe a hadith or two and a few incidents or real life stories in order for us to ponder, and there is a point at the end, inshaAllah ta'ala. As for the first hadith, then we learn in this hadith of a man who committed a sin. He did something which displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he acknowledged that he made a mistake. So he turned to Allah Azza wa Jalla and said, Ya Rabb, إني أذنبت ذنبا فاغفره لي. Oh my Lord, I have committed a sin. So forgive me for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in response, as we learn from the hadith, علم عبدي أن له ربا يغفر الذنب ويأخذ به. غفرت له. My slave, my servant knows that he has a Lord who forgives sins and also holds people accountable for them. But I have forgiven him. Some time passed and again the man committed a sin. And he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Rabbi inni aznabtu dhanban faghfirhu li. O my Lord, I have committed a sin, forgive me for it. And again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, عَلِمَ عَبْدِي أَنَّ لَهُ رَبًّا يَغْفِرُ الذَّنْبَ وَيَأْخُذُ بِهِ. My slave knows that he has a Lord who forgives sins, but he also holds accountable, holds people accountable for the same. غَفَرْتُ لَهُ, but I have forgiven him. And this continued several times. The man would sin, and then he would turn and say, Ya Allah, I've committed a sin, forgive me for it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, My slave knows that he has a Lord who forgives. And he also knows that he has a Lord who takes people to account for their sins. But I have forgiven him. And it continued to happen, until finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, علم عبدي أن له ربا يغفر الذنب ويأخذ به فقد غفرت له فليعمل عبدي ما شاء. Absolutely amazing how this hadith ends. Finally, this man again he commits a sin and he turns to Allah begging for forgiveness, and Allah Azza wa Jalla finally says, My slave knows that he has a Lord who forgives, but that he also takes people to account. I have forgiven him, and now no matter what my slave does, I have forgiven him. In other words, even if he committed this sin again millions of times over, I have forgiven him. Allah Azza wa Jalla decided to forgive him. Keep that hadith in mind. Let's fast forward to this century. The two incidents I'm about to relate to you happened over the last few years. One of them is of a sheikh that I personally know, or know of, I should say, in Al-Madinah. From his piety, his taqwa of Allah Azza wa Jal, he lives in Medina and he has lessons that he does in Makkah and in Jeddah. It's about a 4-hour drive. But the sheikh refuses to ever board an aircraft. He always would drive on his own. Tired, he'd finished teaching at the university. And then he'd race off to Jeddah and to Makkah to deliver lectures, because there were students waiting for him there in the masjid. He never ever took a plane. Then one day, one of the students who knows him saw him at the airport. Came to the sheikh and he said, Ya sheikh, what's the matter? You never ever board a plane. How come you're going to board a plane now? Maybe I should tell you how come the sheikh doesn't board a plane. He said, I hate to board planes because the stewardesses on the plane don't wear hijab and they wear makeup. And I'm afraid that I will be tempted by one of them. I don't want my eyes to fall on them and then Allah Azza wa Jalla will be angry with me. حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. So the student's asking this here, I mean, what are you doing boarding a plane? Now, the Sheikh tells his student, listen, I'm going to tell you, but don't tell anybody. But you know Muslims. MashaAllah, we hear it, we have to spread it. Now I'm telling you, but I won't take his name. The Sheikh says, I'll tell you, but don't tell anybody about it. He said, you know what? My mother loves a particular type of date, and this morning she mentioned that she wants to eat that date, and that date can only be found in Al-Riyadh. Al-Riyadh is like a 12-hour drive from Medina. Said, wallahi, just to please my mother, I'm going to bring her those dates and come back. Birru al-walidain. This is what it is to be dutiful to your parents. Leave that. Let me tell you about two individuals that I am very close to. I have a very good and close relationship to. Many people in this masjid know one of those individuals. He used to live here. He doesn't live here anymore. Another individual, I know him in Vancouver. These two individuals, I always wondered that they would sometimes make decisions which seemed fairly silly. That they were doing something that would land them in a great bit of a lot of trouble financially. But subhanAllah, no matter how stupid a decision they make, everything turns out fine. As a matter of fact, they get more barakah, more blessings. And I always wondered why. Until wallahi ahibbati fillah, I saw with my own eyes and I heard with my own ears the way that they dealt with their parents. When I spoke to one of their mothers and when I actually dealt face to face with one of their parents, I can tell you that there wasn't a sentence that they uttered except that they made dua, they supplicated for their son. Every sentence, barakallahu fee, rabbana yarda anhu. Yeah, everything was, may Allah be pleased with him, may Allah bless him, may Allah grant him happiness, may Allah grant him, every sentence practically. Because of the way that he used to treat his parents, each of these individuals. We go to the Quran and we hear about those individuals, تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا ومما رزقناهم ينفقون. We spoke about them a few nights ago. Those who are not comfortable in their beds, they lie down on their beds, but it doesn't last. They're driven out of their beds and they stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the night while people are sleeping. And when asked what drives them to that, they say that they remember the hellfire and they remember the sins that they committed. And so they were not comfortable lying in their beds. And so they would stand up before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in prayer. And there are so many. Let me give you one more incident. Also, it is now in this century, the Shaykh, Shaykh Muhammad Hassan, hafizahullahu ta'ala, who is alive and well, kicking and alive today, he relates this incident. He knows it firsthand from a colleague of his from the university that in the town that he is in. He says, my colleague relates to me that he became quite ill. And in order for him to be treated, he had to go to London. He went to England from Egypt. He went there and he was shocked to find out that he had some very severe heart problem. There were some arteries that were completely blocked and the doctors told him, listen, you have to have it operated on, but it's a very, very risky operation. Chances of you surviving are not that high. So as any of us would do, he thought, well, I have to get it done, but my family, let me go back home, see my family, and, you know, tie up loose ends, because he was expecting that he's going to die. So he took permission from the doctors. They said, okay, but you have to take a particular medication while you're there. He went. He comes back to Egypt. He says, one day I was sitting with a friend of mine. I was sitting with this friend of mine, and just opposite us was a butcher. I mean, butchers are not like Brother Bashir here or there. You know, over there it's a little bit different. Bones will be thrown to the side, the fat on the floor. So the butcher was busy, and he saw a woman. He couldn't help but notice this woman. And this poor thing would go and pick up some bones. And she would pick up the fat that the butcher would throw as well. And you know, with the fat, maybe there's a little bit of meat. And the man was touched, and he said, what's going on? So he went towards her, and out of respect, he said, come here, my mother. Tell me, what's happening? She said to him, wallahi, I have 6 daughters. For the last 8 months, I have not been able to give them any meat. I'm trying to gather up whatever little I can. At least they will have the taste of meat after 8 months. Immediately this brother thought, wow, how ungrateful are we? A day doesn't go by except that we throw away barakat, blessings that have been sent to us by Allah Azza wa Jalla. Think about your own home. How much food do we throw away? In any event, he thought about that, and then he said to her, how much meat do you need? I want you to remember, it's for 6 daughters. And herself, of course. She said, 1/2 kilo is enough. 1/2 kilo, it's about 1 pound. For 7 of them? He said, are you sure 1/2 kilo is enough for the 6 daughters? She said, more than enough. So he says to the butcher, give her 2 kilos of meat. 2 kilos of meat. And then he says to her, listen, mother, do this. Every week, you come to this butcher and take from him 2 kilos of meat. Ask Bashir, 2 kilos of meat every week, 1 month, how much is that? At the end of the year, how much is it? He says, listen, who's going to pay for all of this? He says, how much is it? Give me the account. I'll pay you 1 year in advance. So he paid 1 year in advance. The man swears to Sheikh Muhammad that this woman, when she heard this news, she fell to her knees and she raised her hands and she made such dua. She begged of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless this man and to give him good health and to make him prosper. So much, he said, I felt as though my heart was going to come out of my chest. And he cried as he heard this woman supplicate to Allah azza wa jalla for him. Then he went back to his friend and he sat for some time and he says, I'd never felt so comfortable before. So I started feeling healthier. And then I went home and I knocked on the door and my daughter answered. One of my daughters answered. And she said, what's happening? You look so happy and excited. What happened? She says, you know what? This is what happened to me today with this woman. And the daughter as well raised her hands. And she said, oh Allah, the way he brought happiness to that old woman, bring happiness to him by curing him of his illness. And now he felt very healthy. So he said to his family, you know what, forget about England. I don't need to go back. I feel strong, healthy as a horse. But they said, come on, you have these block parties, go back. You have to get this operation done. So he goes back. He goes back, and as all of us know, pre-op, they have to do some tests and make sure that everything is still okay. So the doctor orders some tests and x-rays and whatever else is necessary. And the man goes into the doctor's office and the doctor looks at him and he looks at his computer screen and he looks at him again. He looks at his file. Says something's wrong. Orders another set of tests just to make sure. Something seems very wrong. And finally, the doctor says to him, when you went back home, what on earth did you do? He says, why? He says, well, those arteries that were blocked, they're no longer blocked. You don't need an operation. You're as healthy as a horse. He says, wallahi, I've never cried so much in my life before. And he says, I responded to the doctor who asked me, what did you do when you went back home? He said, oh, when I went back home, I had a transaction, tijara. I traded with Allah, with my Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ay wallah. And what a profitable trade. He gave for the sake of Allah azza wa jal, and look at the response. Now, as soon as you hear that incident, you should think of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. داووا مرضاكم بالصدقة. Treat your ill with sadaqah, with charity. Those men who and women who wake up in the middle of the night, yes, they thought about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They thought about Jahannam. They thought about Jannah. That man who would commit sin after sin, but he would acknowledge that he committed a sin and turn to Allah. He knew that Allah Azza wa Jal is severe in his punishment, just as he knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most forgiving. So instead of trying to justify his wrong, he turned to Allah Azza wa Jal. The point I want to get at from all of these incidents is this. Those individuals were prosperous and they benefited because they knew with whom they were dealing. They knew with whom they were dealing. They knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth and all that lies between them, and all that is beneath the earth and that which lies in the oceans, the creator of all these things, owns the treasures of the heavens and the earth. They knew it. And therefore, when they heard promises from Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, when they heard promises from Allah Azza wa Jalla through the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they acted upon them. They knew with whom they were. Do you and I know whom we are dealing with? Or when we hear these ahadith, do we say, oh, it makes me feel so warm and fuzzy. Oh, so nice. We should share this with other people. It's not just to feel nice about things. When you hear these ayat, when I hear these ayat, when you and I hear these ahadith, we have to live them. We have to understand that we are dealing with Allah Azza wa Jal. Those promises are not made to us by a human being, by a creature who can promise you the world and then not deliver. You know what they say about human beings? Or what they say when we deal with one another? If somebody offers you something that sounds too good to be true, it's too good to be true. With Allah Azza wa Jal, it all sounds too good to be true, but all of it is true. The way we deal with Allah has to be different than the way we deal with one another. We hear the ayat, we hear the ahadith, but we don't respond. Why? Believe me, it's because we have not realized whom we are dealing with. Ahibbati fillah. Know Allah Azza wa Jal. Turn to the Quran. In Salat al-Isha, we recited the greatest ayah in the Quran, Ayat al-Kursi. Billahi alaykum. Many of you, maybe most of you, have memorized that verse and you repeat it in parrot fashion, but probably only when you suspect that somebody has possessed you or you know, dropped the evil eye on you, but not regularly. This is the reality. But how many of us have really pondered over the meanings of Ayat al-Kursi? Go and learn Ayat al-Kursi and learn the meanings of it. Because in it, you will learn whom you are dealing with, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you and I appreciate, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. Wallahi, we have not appreciated Allah as we should appreciate Him. Had we appreciated Allah Azza wa Jal for who He is, had we known Allah Azza wa Jal, our lives would be very different. The way that we carry on, the way that we conduct ourselves would be very different. Our masajid would be packed all the time. We would be looking for places to give our money. We would be, if we had somebody who was sick in the home. Remember, I also related to you a hadith the other night about Qiyamul Layl. From amongst the benefits of Qiyamul Layl, as we heard in that hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, besides it being the way of the righteous before us, besides it being a means of expiating and earning forgiveness for sins, besides it being a means of deterring us from committing sins, the Prophet ﷺ also told us that it is a means of repelling illness and sickness from the body. How many of us thought about that and we said, I'm not feeling well, so let me pray 2 rak'ah for Allah Azza wa Jal at night when everybody else is sleeping? How many of us, wallahi, have done such a thing? Or have given something for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal? We saw an orphan, and so we rubbed his head, and we gave him some money. Because we said, دَعُوا مَرْضَاكُمْ بِالصَّدَقَةِ. or at least you saw somebody sick and you gave them money, or you assisted them in getting treatment, because you remember that hadith. And as for the orphan, you thought about how you need the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, and you thought about how the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us that if you were to treat an orphan well, if you were to take an orphan under your wing and sponsor that orphan, then you will be with him like this in Jannah. You will be his neighbor in Jannah. How many of us, when we see these things in front of us, we think immediately, oh, Allah promised this. Oh, the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah will give me this. Are we doing it? This is my question to myself first, and then the rest of you. أحبتي في الله. Let's learn with whom we are dealing. Then inshaAllah ta'ala, we will be like those individuals we heard of in these incidents I related to you. I beg of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who, when we hear the promises from Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we immediately act in order to receive what Allah jalla wa ala has promised us. هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.